Man. Oh, well, he said 7:30. 7:30. It's 8 o'clock. I've got to get on with this. There'll be people turning up any minute now. Oh, no. No. How am I going to do? That's my guest star. If he doesn't arrive, what's going to happen? He hasn't even called in or anything at all. Come on. Hurry up. Get a move on. Oh. For the neck at last. All right, yeah. Hello, where are you? Are you outside? You what? You're not coming. You're still down, you're 200 miles away. You decided you couldn't be bothered and you're not coming. Marvellous, thank you. I mean, could you let me know, 2 hours in advance or something, an hour in advance even? I spoke to you 2.5 hours ago. You were ready to come then? Okay, listen, it's 8 o'clock. There's people on here. I'm live streaming. Just forget it, okay? All right, I'll call you. Don't call me, I'll call you, okay? All right, yeah, bye. For heaven's sake! What on earth is going on here? Well, we've got a new post from Keith Wilson. We've got Christine, Chris is here. Anne Blair's here. Our special guest, as you may have just heard in the background, is not here. Terrible situation. I don't know what we're going to do. I do know exactly what we're going to do. We're going to have a different special guest. But anyway, I'm going to start off. Normally these things start off with the theme tune for the day, but obviously I'm dealing with special guests who don't let you know what's going on this week. Okay. It's quite enough of that. Get it out of my system. Right. Instead, we'll play the theme tune for today. Just give me one moment to get ready. And here we go.
Thank you. Yes, well, as I'm sure some of you will know, possibly, anybody else there? Christine's here, Anne's here, everybody else is not here, it would seem, otherwise that, or alternatively, Facebook simply isn't telling me who's here, which is quite common with Facebook, I think. Right, well, that was, as I'm sure both of you know, the theme from The Good, the Bad and the Ugly, composed by Italian film composer Ennio Morricone. He writes other things apart from film music as well, but he's mostly known for his music for the westerns, the spaghetti westerns. All right, Willow, good to see you. Yeah, he's basically best known for the... hey, Emily's here, you've just missed the opening spectacular. I might even play it again. In fact, you know what? I'm going to play it again as people are coming in. Let me just retrieve my recorder, and I'll get that up, and we'll do a reprise, because it's great, it's a nice little tune to play. Whoop. It doesn't want to play it. Okay. It's behaving a little oddly, just bear with me one moment here. There we are! Yes, there we are. Yes, Don Humphreys, switched on the phone. First thing I see is my mic playing Good, the Bad, the Ugly on recorder. How good is modern technology? Yeah, absolutely. Is he there yet? No, he's not there yet, Steve. All right, okay, everybody. Again, that was The Good, the Bad, and the Ugly by the great Italian film composer Ennio Morricone. And quickly, it was played. Let's introduce the instruments. Emily asked about the instruments, so let's introduce the ones I'm using tonight. This is the Aulos Elite Descant Recorder. Don't be fooled by the fact that it's called Aulos Elite. It's actually the cheapest basic school recorder they produce, and you can get one on Amazon for like a fiver. That said, it's a perfectly serviceable plastic recorder. nothing wrong with it at all. Pretty well, decently in tune. Yes, the last time I did one of these, 2 weeks ago, I woke up the next morning, and as some of you are possibly aware, my eyesight's pretty dodgy in the morning. Sometimes it's okay, sometimes it's absolutely terrible. And on that occasion, it was just everything was a fog. Couldn't see anything at all. Wanted to listen to some music, but couldn't actually see any names on the backs of CDs or anything whatsoever. So I just literally grabbed something at random, shot it in the machine, fumbled away at the controls, short-sightedly, and put it on play. And what came out was a set of arrangements for piano of music by another Italian film composer, Nino Rota. And I thought, interesting film music. Right, okay. Okay, that's a theme. Let's try that. So, dotted throughout the next hour or so, there are going to be odd bits of, and sometimes very odd bits of, film music. Also, we've got in store for you, we've got a bit of ska to come up. Steve having technical difficulties? Am I having technical difficulties? No, okay, yeah, Andy's here. Hi, Andy. Jason's here. Hi, Jason. Terry's here. Evening, Terry. Everything all right? Let's go back to where I can see myself on the screen. For some reason, that's more comforting. Don't know why. At this point, I would normally introduce the drinking vessel for the evening, but I haven't actually got a drinking vessel this evening. That's because I've been having raging toothache for the last 2 days, and if I put anything much in my mouth, possibly including a saxophone, it just sort of sends shooting pains up the right-hand side of my head. So, as a consequence of that, I've got an awful lot of saliva, which you didn't need to know about, but it does mean that I don't really need to drink any liquid. So, carrying on with the occasional piercing scream taking place, possibly, film music, yeah. So, let's go back to where I started with that disc of music by Nino Rota. And we'll play something here when I can find the file again. Yes, we've got it. Right. And this should be something that you all know. Rota wrote a lot of music for the films of Federico Fellini, including one of my all-time favourites, 8 and a Half. This is something for a Hollywood blockbuster, and I expect you all know it. Let's prepare the tenor recorder here. Start that again. It helps to know what key you're playing in.
What?
Well, that got a little bit blocky, so, and slightly threw me off, so sorry about that. A rather approximate performance there of the love theme from The Godfather, which I expect some of you recognised. Big film in, what, 1972, was it? Or was it 1971? Can't remember. Anybody remember? Give me a clue here. So what have we got? Phil's here! Yay! Steve, can't get the live video on my tablet, so switch to my phone. David Fowler's here. Hi, Dave. Right, lots of people coming in. Have we got Phil Martin? I'm not seeing Phil Martin because he's got a request piece in, as he usually does, and I was going to play that next, but he's not here. So, well, 17 minutes past 8. Let's carry on and give it a go with something else. Carrying on with film music, let's get round to Michael Nyman. Now, Michael Nyman is a quite popular composer these days. Writes concertos. Recently he's writing symphonies. He started off as a minimalist composer in the school of people like Philip Glass, Steve Reich. Do these names mean anything to anybody? American composers writing music that was very repetitive. Lots of patterns repeated over and over and over. In the very popular in the 70s and the 80s. Nyman was kind of like the English side of this sort of thing, with a particular trick, which was that he applied minimalist principles of repetition to the music of classical composers. Sometimes this bordered on plagiarism, but we'll get round to that in a moment, and being careful saying that, really. First, a demonstration of how he used his approach. There was a piece on his first album in 1981 called In Re Don Giovanni, meaning concerning Don Giovanni. Don Giovanni is an opera by Mozart, and Nyman's piece takes the first 20 seconds of an aria from Don Giovanni and treats it in a certain way. I'll just play the first 20 seconds for you, if I can find it. Yep, there we go. Right, now in that example, there are basically four musical components. There's a rhythmic figure played by the strings. There are two counterpoint rhythmic figures played by wind instruments. And there's a melody put over the top by the vocalist. Now what Nyman did in his cover version of this piece was to stretch it out so that each of those four elements is introduced one after the other and played twice. And once they've all been played, the piece ends because there's nowhere further to go. I'm going to try this again. Let's give it a good blow through. Right, let's hope it stands up. I will point out that this is a piece that starts off really, really difficult and gets easier as it goes along, so wish me luck. Thank you. So it's quite a clubby little piece, and it gives some idea of how this particular composer works out what he's doing. Now, where are you? Right, Emily, look down. Oh, am I looking up at the ceiling again? Yes. And for some reason, I've got the microphone put directly above the laptop, and for some reason, it's tempting for me to look at the microphone instead of at the camera, largely because I can't actually see the camera, it's just a kind of like black thing. Anyway, I'll try. Rick is here. Hello, mate. Right, okay, yeah, it's educational, I'm doing that. And there's no farting. Well, wait and see. Although I really haven't eaten very much today, so it might be a bit of an effort to squeeze one out. I'll do my best, Dave, honestly. Look down, not look down. Oh, lockdown, right. Did she say lockdown? She said lockdown. I can't even read what it says. Maybe I should wear my glasses, but to be honest, these days that makes things worse. Right, okay, so where were we? Yep, I'm going to carry on with Nyman. Let's get this. Let's do a whole Michael Nyman trunk for your benefit. In 1982, Nyman had established a collaboration for several films with a filmmaker named Peter Greenaway, who made a lot of really good films throughout the 1980s. A set of Zed and Two Noughts, Drowning by Numbers, Prospero's Books, the wonderfully titled The Cook, The Thief, His Wife and Her Lover. And also, one of my all-time favourite films came out in 1982 called The Draftsman's Contract, which is where Michael Nyman wrote a score which sounded marvellously like the music of the late 17th century for a film that was set in the late 17th century. Little did lots of people realise that actually the music which Nyman was claiming copyright on had been written by Henry Purcell in the late 17th century, and he was largely just doing arrangements of it, which is, I don't know, it seems to me to be a bit of a questionable thing to do. But anyway, great film. If you get a chance to see it, find it on YouTube or wherever, do give it a go. It's very 17th century. You'll need sort of some idea of restoration culture to make much headway with it. But very interesting, beautifully filmed, great score, and I'm going to have a bash here on the Yamaha plastic treble recorder and a piece from it called Chasing Sheep Is Best Left to Shepherds. Thank you. apologise for really lax performance standards tonight. Probably because of the shooting damn pain in the right side of my face. But, anyway, carrying on, where were we? We're back at the screen. Absolutely. Jason Sorville, I didn't know that Nyman plagiarised Mozart. I learn something new every day. Check out the score for Drowning by Numbers, Jace. Quite apart from the Don Giovanni piece, Drowning by Numbers is pretty much all Mozart. In 1983, no one died. In 1984, no one died. In 1986, there was the incident with the pigeon. Mock Baroque, absolutely. Jazz. Nice. Debbie, hi! And we get to make instruments with sticky back plastic occasionally too. Haven't got any of those this week. Is anybody actually still there? Because I'm getting a message now that's saying, we're having trouble playing this video. So I've got no kind of picture of what I'm doing at all. Anybody post in and say, if anyone can post in the comments and say, can you actually see me? Or can you, because I can't see myself. It just says, sorry, we're having trouble with playing this video. Why is it that things go wrong so often with Facebook? Right, okay, well, in the absence of anybody coming in for the time being and saying, yes, you're on screen, or no, I've just got a big blank and everything stops. Andy, thank you. We're still here and we can see you. That's great. Well, I don't need to see myself. I don't want to see myself, in actual fact. So, right, great. I'll carry on and I'll finish off the Michael Nyman section. He had a bit of a breakthrough in the early 90s with a film called The Piano, which some of you may remember, some of you may have seen. A film about a mute woman and a piano abandoned on a beach in New Zealand. Very touching, very powerful film. And Nyman wrote a very melodic score for it and arranged it into a piano concerto, which became enormously popular for a bit. Everyone was recording it. Pretty much every orchestra in the country was putting it into their concert lists. Nice piece of work. So I'm going to play one of the themes from that. He paused slightly as he dug out the Roessler Pearwood recorder with German fingering. I don't know if you can see that. It's got two solid holes down there. If I find another recorder to compare with, that's got... Can you see that those have two little holes so that you can get your C-sharp, D-sharp? You can't do those on the German fingering style. It's, I think, not found much outside Germany these days. Anyway, enough of that. A little bit of recorder education again. Where are we? Film music. Alright, yeah. Right, Nyman. This is called The Heart Asks Pleasure First. Thank you. do like that piece. It's a nice tune, slightly irregular. Something you can get very passionate with. Right, okay, how are we going? Trevor! Trevor! Trevor loves it. I'm not sure what you love, Trevor. Steve, how close have you been to the old string tied to a door for your tooth? I'm trying to avoid that. The problem, of course, is at the moment there's no dental treatment. You can't do it. You can get a helpline, you can talk to a dentist, and the dentist will say, well, you know, floss, use mouthwash, take painkillers, best of luck. So it's a question of just hanging on until that kind of thing gets back to normal. Paul Ryan's got a thumb up. There he is. And Steve can see me as well. And yep, Willow's in row 4, seat 11. I hope you socially distanced there, mate. Preferably you're in row 4, seat 11, and there's no row 4, 9, 10, 12 or 13. Trevor, yes we can. Terry, yeah, everybody can see me. Too low. Right. Mike, up. Trevor, up. Sex face. Okay. Right, I'm not going to do that. Where we are. Right, okay. A. Yes. Right, okay. Well, it looks like you're all having a good time there. I still can't see anything. It's still telling me. Sorry, we're having trouble with playing this video, so it'd be interesting when I try to save it, actually. I wonder what will come out. So where are we? Okay, it's now, good lord, it's actually 8:30. So it's time for another piece by Nino Rota, which some of you may know. It's from Franco Zaffirelli's 1968, I think, or 1967 possibly, film of Romeo and Juliet. Cleverly closed the folder that contained that sort of thing. Yep, here we go. We're going to try with the tenor recorder again. This, by the way, is actually the nicest recorder I own, but it does tend to block a little bit quickly. It's a hardwood Moog Rothenburg tenor recorder. So I expect a few people will actually know this one. Depends on what age you are, I suppose, really. Anyway, this is the love theme, again, from Romeo and Juliet. Thank you. From Romeo and Juliet by Nino Rota, subtitled In Capulet's Tomb. Now, let's see if we've got the picture back yet. No, we're still having trouble with playing this video. Right, anybody there? Oh, you held... right, okay. Steve, you held the recorders too low so we couldn't see the difference. Ah, Luke's here. When are you getting the sax out? Well, as I explained before you arrived, Luke, I've actually got a raging toothache, so I'm not playing a lot of sax. Don't worry, it's going to come very shortly. Laney's here. Hello, Laney. Right, what have we got? Andy, splendid. Right, well, I'm going to do the comedy section now. No sticky back plastic or constructing musical instruments out of bits of bleached containers or anything this week. What we have is that tune that I just played. It was actually the music that was used for a particularly soggy radio feature on Radio 1 for many years and then on Smooth Radio for many years by DJ Steve Bates, and it was called Our Tune. And he used to play that music in the background while reciting a tale of heartbreak and love, which would culminate in playing the tune, special piece of music, for the people whose story he had just told. And as it happens, I've prepared a story, so I'm going to play an extended version of the music that you just heard and attempt, in Simon Bates style, to recite this special, wonderful love story. I recommend you all get your hankies out right now, or if no hankies, get a Kleenex, bit of bog roll if you must. You'll need it. You'll be in tears. You will be heartbroken by the end of this, I can pretty much guarantee it. Right, where are we then? Back to the folder. Okay. Let's go. Today, we bring you the story of a couple whose love seems to be a thing of perfection made in heaven. But then, the world appeared to turn against them. We will call our pair of lovers Doris and Bominic. Although they had worked in similar fields for some time, it was only when Doris noticed something which Bominic had written on the side of a large red bus that she realised how special he might be to her. From that moment on, all their friends agreed that they seemed to be a perfect couple and most surely had a fine and marvellous future in front of them. And at first, things went slowly, but well, the two worked away separately for a while, but then Bominic was able to help Doris to get the job she had always dreamed of. After that, they vowed that they would never be parted, and the sun seemed to shine brightly on their love. They set about making up all sorts of marvellous plans through which they could share their love and happiness with everyone else in the land. But then, things went wrong. People began to fall ill from a mysterious virus, and Doris and Bominic weren't sure what to do. As they struggled with this dreadful interruption for their lovely plans for the people, Doris herself became ill and had to hide away from everyone for weeks on end. Distraught with grief, Bominic ran away from Doris's house, and then, feeling that he too was sick, drove his wife and child to another part of the country. All of this led a nasty, ungrateful public to nag and persecute our star-crossed lovers. But their love was too strong to be so easily broken. Doris stood by her man, while Bominic explained that it had all happened because he had weird eyesight which needed testing. Will everyone believe them? Will the nasty, ungrateful public stop hounding them? Will the future bring more sunshine? Or more tears and tragedy? We don't know. But we do know that through it all, the couple shared one special song, which they called Our Tune. We're going to play it for you now, with love from Doris and Bominic. And we'll be back tomorrow at approximately the same time, or possibly in 2 weeks' time, with another tale of tragedy and heartbreak. Or perhaps we won't. Perhaps instead, we'll have a guest appearance by last week's guest star, Dickie Duck. Hi, Dickie. Still dressed as the Flash, I see. Dickie says it's a full-time job being a superhero. You brought... Was that Dickie? You brought along... You brought along a new... You got a new child. Wow. Okay. And you're looking for a job. Dickie says he's got a new child and he thinks he'd make a very good Prime Minister. Where's your new child, Dickie? Ah, oh, isn't that sweet? Dickie and his little baby. So you can start a petition off. Anybody wants to start a petition calling for Dickie Duck for Prime Minister, Dickie, for one, would be extremely grateful. And it's quite possible that some of the nation would be as well. Right, okay, Dickie, go off and see to your little sibling. Don't run away too fast because he'll fall off your back. Right, time is moving on and I haven't had the saxophone out yet, so there's lots and lots to do. Oh, look, that's interesting. I can see myself. And now I can't see myself. Oh, well, I'll carry on not seeing myself. I think I prefer that. Terry says, hello, Dickie. Yep, absolutely. Dave, DD 4pm. Absolutely, it's a slogan. Let's get it going. We'll work on this. I think you'd do a better job than the present incumbent. Anyway, right, saxophone. Let's get a bit of saxophone out. Pete Martin. I haven't seen Pete here, actually. Emily. yeah, you've been to the pound shop, Mike. Emily, I live in the pound shop when there isn't a lockdown going on. I have so many things from the pound shop, some of them including rubber ducks. Right, where are we going? Yeah, Pete requested a piece of music with saxophone, so I'll actually get that going right now. As we've got quite a lot to get through, it seems. Oh look, I've closed the folder again. Here we are. Right, let's get the saxophone strapped up. I shall approximately attempt to busk along with an absolute ska reggae classic from the early days, relatively early days of the career of the fabulous Lee Scratch Perry. Let's go.
Boom, boom.
Yay! Absolute belter. Absolute belter of a hit single from 1968, was it, Andy?
I remember listening to that on the radio and thinking, what is this? I have no idea what this is, but it's fantastic. So, here we are again, still having trouble playing this video. Bleeding Gums Murphy, absolutely, Steve, that's exactly right. So, you all seem to have been completely... 1969, Andy, right, okay, okay. It's a false memory on my part then, I associate it with some things that were happening in 68. But yeah, okay, I do that, I do that kind of thing. Can't remember it exactly. 69, still a fantastic year. A bit more saxophone now, as some of you on here will have seen, Steve Mack has posted up a guitar piece called Imperfect World on YouTube and linked to it on Facebook. He also sent me a copy which doesn't have guitar soloing all the way through it, and I'm now going to attempt to do something with it. I'll first switch on a microphone so I can get a bit of effect on this. Whoa, loads and loads of delay. Okay, right, so this is the this is my jam on Steve's track. And I've absolutely no idea, I've never tried it before. We're just going to see how it comes out. If I can locate... Yeah, we've got it here. Let's go. Thank you.
Saxophone for the night. That was really good fun, actually. I must go back and do some more with that. See what kind of possibilities we can work up. Meanwhile, back at the screen. That's sorry, we're in. Yes, still having trouble playing the video. Delay set just so. Very nice. Pure bit of luck. Pete's here. Pete, right? Okay. That track was called "Imperfect World," and it's written by Steve Mack. He's put a version up on YouTube on his own channel. Steve Mack being the leader of the Australian Pink Floyd, and he sent me a copy that wasn't all guitar solos so that I could have a go at it as well. And there it was. Right, Pete, I'm sorry, but you know, I've already done the Return of Django, since it looked like you weren't going to make it. So you're just going to have to go to YouTube later on and check it out. Very chilled atmosphere you're throwing out as well. You know, I'm absolutely out of my head on painkillers. That's why. I don't know how many painkillers I've taken today. At the moment they're working, that's good. So yeah, it's not too painful on the teeth. But that's it for the saxophone for the evening. And it is now 9 o'clock. But I've still got a few things to do. So I'll just turn off the delay on that microphone. And come back in request. I don't know if Luke's still here, but Luke and Steffi last week put in a request for Button Moon, a TV children's program which I knew nothing about. 1980s, I wasn't watching TV at all in the 1980s really. Missed out on it completely. So I went and found it and discovered that it's a 15 second long piece of music. If that, it might even be shorter. Not really something that you can whip up and do as a performance. So I thought, right, let's put together a little medley of children's TV theme tunes. Now Emily, I know, has plans to do this kind of thing, so not to step on Emily's toes, pretty much everything I've done is from when I was a kid, which is about 2,000 years ago. Anyone else who's in the 2,000 year age range will possibly recognise some of these that we're going to get. Let's go with a 3-minute medley of television children's TV theme tunes.
Robot men, robot
And it's not a donkey. Don't call him a donkey. And on that note, I think it's probably time to call a halt to these proceedings so that I can go and chug-a-lug some more zapping and possibly get some beer out as well. Debbie loved Button Moon. Rhubarb and Custard, again, out of my time zone, Andy. So what did we actually have there? We had Sooty. We had Bill and Ben. What came after Bill and Ben? Complete blank. Anyway, we had Sooty, we had Bill and Ben, we had Muffin the Mule. He's not a donkey, he's a mule. We then had Ragtag and Bobtail, the Wooden Tops, Tales from the Riverbank, Button Moon, Looney Tunes, throwing in an American one, which I remember basically is the Tom and Jerry theme tune. And finally finishing with The End Every Tuesday. I think it was Tuesday, was it? Or was it Monday? Anyway. Of Andy Pandy. Great British children's television with a couple of American interlopers. Right, guys, I'm going to head off and find some more painkillers and possibly drink some soup through a straw. Sorry about the shortage of saxophone and so on and all the complaints about the tooth, but hell, toothache, it's not great. With a bit of luck, I will turn up for the next of these. With a huge great bandage, in fact that's probably the plan, get a great big scarf, tie it round my neck and tie it in a knot on the top of my head. Right, okay guys, hope you enjoyed yourselves, I did. Some of these pieces will probably get reprises, now there's a rhyme for you, because frankly some of the performance standards weren't really that great. But anyway, thanks guys, hope you had a good time. Thanks ever so much for attending, all greatly appreciated. For anybody who wants to see all the bits that they might have missed, hi Pete, then I will have, by the end of the evening, I will have this thing loaded up on YouTube. And in fact, it will probably stay on Facebook for the next 24 hours, so you can always go through it there. But I'll put it on YouTube anyway, so it's covered for all the people who couldn't be here. Probably because they didn't want to, but I can't blame them. Right chaps, stay safe. Stay well. Personally, I'm keeping up with the lockdown. I'm not at all keen on going out, even though public transport isn't as dangerous as the government wants you to think it is. Seriously, I have been getting buses, and they're actually safer than walking around on the streets. So, with that in mind, everyone take care. Cheers, Laney. Thank you for co-hosting and adding everybody in. And Terry's got somebody at the door. Au revoir, Dave. Terry, I had somebody at the door the other day. He had 20 cans of Glen Affric, payload pale.
And you know what? I might actually go and have one of those right now. Have fun, guys. See you again in 2 weeks. Unless I go mad and decide to do it again in a week, but 2 weeks is more likely. Enough waffling. Cheers now.